For a geophysicist, gravity can help you understand the Earth's subsurface. This is because the gravity of the Earth varies ever so slightly because of the density of the material below the surface. We can map these gravitational changes, which gives us an indication of where more dense material may occur. A great example of this are things like copper and gold, which are more dense than the rocks surrounding them. But the question is, how do we know whether that dense material is copper or gold? To really characterise what it is, we need to bring in other techniques such as magnetotellurics, geochemistry and petrophysics where we can. Each technique provides a new layer of information and tells us the response and the characteristic of that rock and the geology.
This landscape here, for the most part, there's a thin veneer of soil over the top. There's a huge expanse of land here, and we can't just go sticking in drill holes every 100 metres or so to work out the geology. We want to work out what's underground, and we want to do it without actually digging it up, without actually disturbing the earth. We're surrounded by this invisible field, gravity. If you take any object, and if you drop it, it accelerates. If there's a really big mass, really heavy, dense rock underneath us, that acceleration will be faster, very slightly. If it's a very soft rock, maybe it's a sandstone, it's full of holes, porous, then that acceleration will be slightly slower, just a tiny amount. We have instruments that can measure that acceleration. They're a passive instrument, they don't emit any radiation. These areas of dense rock, potentially, they can be really high in iron, gold, in manganese. And so we've come out to this part of the world to explore what is really considered very prospective land. And this area extends all the way down to the Trans-Australian Railway line, all the way up north to Challenger Mine. So what we do is we design a survey over an area, jump from point to point, generally 1 to 2 kilometres spaced apart. We then take a measurement, move on to our next site using differential GPS to precision of centimetres. There's no digging, there's no drilling. By taking lots of these measurements, perhaps over a regular grid pattern, over large distances, we slowly build up a picture, like we're building up each pixel in a JPEG image. Just the density, just the mass of what's underground. We're here standing on Mount Christie, where we have fresh rock actually outcropping, sticking out of the ground. And this sort of information combined with the gravity, we can build up a really strong understanding of what's going on underground. To come out here, we got to talk about land access, because this isn't our land. This is the traditional land of the Antakarindja Mutu Yatanyara Aboriginal Corporation, and we need to consult with them if we want to do work on their land. Describing to them what we want to do, what sort of outcomes we expect, and how they can be involved in that process. Once we have all this gravity information, we then need to translate that into what's underground. The process of creating a simulated gravitational response, that process, we call that forward modelling. From a computational point of view, it's relatively easy. The inverse problem, though, is much harder. There's all these unknowns underground, and that's a hard problem to solve. That's where the supercomputers come in, that's where machine learning comes in. What would be really helpful for us would be to see some people take this data and use it in new ways. Take the geological information, the gravity, the magnetics, everything, plug it into machine learning algorithms, see what comes out. And by providing some new raw information, they'll look at it in new ways and they'll make new discoveries.